It's Absolute Radio, and tonight my guest from Snow Patrol, Gary Lightbody. Hello.
Hello there.
How are you?
Fine, thank you very much. How are you?
I'm fine, and you're back in show business.
Who's back in show business again. We've been allowed back in the front door, or at least one of the doors, maybe the side door.
Who's looking after the pub?
The pub where...
Well, you've got shares in this pub in New York,
we
right?
do, yes, indeed.
So do you never go and actually work there?
I don't really refer to it as a pub, but... we have a very small stake in a pub in New York. A friend of ours bought a pub, and we put a tiny bit of money in. So it's not as if it's our pub.
Does that not allow you to go and work behind the bar, though?
It allows me to go in and pull pints behind the bar.
That's
I'm not sure working is the appropriate word for it, but I've been known to be in behind the bar, depending on how drunk I am.
Did you ever do bar work before you were a musician?
That was virtually the only work that I did before. I worked in 10 pubs and clubs.
Did you ever have to deal with any trouble?
A few times, but... luckily, there was other staff on hand as well to handle the heavy lifting.
So, do you have to memorise the list of people who've been barred then every day before you start your shift?
Well, I didn't work in any bear pits. I mean, there was a few pubs that were maybe a little frightening at some days, but most days it wasn't like sort of flying pint glasses and people screaming at each other.
Lucky, really.
Yeah.
So you've said, with regards to the new album, which comes out in November, you've said that you went through a period of having writer's block.
Yes.
I mean, is that like song constipation?
that's one uncomfortable way of putting it. Yeah.
I mean, are you straining to force out a song in that situation?
There is an element of that, and then that descends into not trying anymore.
So you think if you walk away from it, that's going to
And the walking away from it becomes staying away from it. And then you're in a very dark place indeed.
So how do you fill your time? I mean, did you take up model railways? Was it fell walking?
Mostly model railways, yeah. That was a good guess, first off. We were in Santa Monica. It's not the most terrible place to be footloose and fancy free.
So were you out there with the purpose of writing and then recording the album? Is that
yeah, I mean,
there?
I'd written a bunch of the music, really. It's not very often, not very seldom referred to as a bunch of music, a collective term.
Yeah.
But I'd written a lot of the music, or at least the melodies. But the lyrics hadn't come yet, and I was expecting them to come easier than they did. But it was about a 3-month period where we had this, put everything on ice, and the guys did an awful lot of playing together, and I did an awful lot of soul searching to try and find my soul.
and is it there?
I found it in the end. It's always in the last place you look.
Are you someone who draws a lot on your own real life to write songs, or are you somebody who likes characters and stories?
Well, this is the thing. I mean, up to this record, I'd pretty much written about my own life. You know, this record is my life interspersed with family and friends and people that I'd met in America. I tried to build it into a kind of a world. Rather than just writing, specifically about people, I built them into characters, even though they were
based on
real life. But for the most part, it feels like its own little world. For the first time, rather than my little world, it's its own little world. So this is something I sort of learned from doing the Tired Pony record a little bit.
Sure.
Character based stuff.
Because it must be difficult when your life gets to a certain stage where you go to the cash machine and you don't ever have to worry when you're waiting for that little noise.
I still worry.
Yeah, but you don't have to. Is the point. And everything's going well. You're internationally successful. Unless you're a rapper, it's quite difficult to write and use that as any kind of pool of resource.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, up to there's still a few, I guess, love songs or relationship songs on this record, but there's very few compared to previous Snow Patrol albums. You know, they were kind of all about my relationships and how I'd been a fool. but this time around, it's a much bigger universe I'm writing about. I guess I had to branch out and widen the scope because I have you know, tread that ground before. I didn't want to just say the same thing again.
Something I find sort of remarkable about and admirable about you is you're not all over the newspapers, and I can't quite work out why that is. I'd be interested to hear from your point of view. There are other people in your position, be it, for example, Chris Martin, whoever, who if they're leaving a pub, they're having the photograph taken the whole time, or they're cropping up in gossip columns. Not that they're particularly nurturing that. Whereas you're a striking, recognisable presence, and yet somehow you seem to keep your head under the radar quite a lot.
My remedy to that is never leave the pub. That's my answer to pretty much everything. That's why. As Homer Simpson says, beer is the cause of and solution to all of our problems. I don't know. We've never really been a very pappable, if that's even a word, band. I guess we just keep ourselves to the dark and dingy bars.
But the newspapers would think this guy sold this many records. It only goes to the logic follows that if I stick a picture of him in my newspaper, it will sell a few more newspapers.
I can't imagine that would it? Really?
Well, I don't think so. That's the logic.
Yeah, that would be
in lieu of any actual news.
Yes, it would have to be a very slow news day.
We're going to play the new track, which is the title track from the new album, Fallen Empires. What can you tell me about this song?
Well, it's a rabid beast of a thing. It's the most unusual song on the record for sure, and I guess that makes it unusual to name the album after it being, you know, probably the most out there kind of song on it. But I just loved the imagery of Fallen Empires, even though it was kind of named after we'd finished the music rather than the lyrics. Because it's what it made me think.
Right.
And then I kind of wrote Stream of Consciousness. This song is in every way the most kind of individual thing on the record, because lyrics are a thing that I normally take a long time over when I can't actually write. And this song I wrote Stream of Consciousness. You know, we did three or four passes and I did it Stream of Consciousness, and then we put the best. Like a puzzle almost.
So this is you freestyling.
This is me freestyling. As close to freestyling as it gets.
You've discovered synthesizers with aplomb then.
We always knew they were there.
Right.
I guess the synth to guitar ratio on this record has become, you know, more favorable to synths, but there's still plenty of guitars. But we've just stripped the overlaid guitars back on this record. You know, it's not like a wall of guitars, maybe five or six guitars doing the same thing on previous records that were probably unnecessary when I think back on it. But Nathan Connolly, especially, has, you know, it's like, why use six guitars when one guitar will do, you know? And he's this record, he's really just pulled something magical out of the bag on every song.
Was that difficult when you were using all that guitar, when you come to playing it live? How do you make the noise of six guitars without six guitarists?
You just get a really good sound man,
right?
And he does some of that work for you. We have the best sound man in the world. Although don't tell him that. I'll tell him not to listen to this interview. His head will swell up.
How's your bus driver?
Our bus driver, well, it depends who you get, really.
Because it does seem to be a common thing that they've often got a touch of the serial killer about them.
Yeah, well, our first bus driver on the first night of the first European tour that we ever did with a proper sleeper bus. We were on tour with Supergrass. It was 1999, I think. We were going around Europe. We were on the ferry to, Dover to Calais or whatever. He got put in the brig. Is it the brig? Is it the boat jail?
Yeah, boat jail is the brig.
He got put in the brig for touching up a woman on the boat.
Oh God!
And then we got back to the bus, And then, you know, he was released on the other side after an hour or two. And we got back to the bus and we realized that he'd stolen a bunch of stuff from us. Well, somebody had stolen a bunch of stuff from us. And we don't steal from each other.
Right. Yeah,
do you know what
yeah.
I mean? It's like, who might be the guy that's stealing from us?
You know, was like, pointing down the front of that bus.
Not the smartest guy in the world, probably.
Wow.
But yeah, that was our first experience. And probably it's, you know, we've had gun-toting rednecks drive us around in the States, but they're normally quite fun as well. You don't quite know what you're going to get.
What is the closest as a band, as a group, you've ever come to death?
Probably driving over the Alps. Any time we've driven over the Alps.
Right.
Because
windy roads, big buses.
Yeah, it's always nighttime and it's like frozen over because it's the Alps and your bus driver's insane. There you are. Bless bus drivers' hearts. You know, it's a tough, tough job, you know. But yeah. And especially when they've got a screaming bunch of idiots in the back.
It takes a certain type of personality.
Absolutely, yeah.
And to police the toilet on a tour bus, that is a tough thing. That falls to the bus driver as well. They're very strict about that.
They're very strict about certain rules.
Yes.
Go into.
I must compliment you, actually. You touched on the early days there. I must compliment you on what I believe is the best song title in the whole of the rock and roll canon.
Okay.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Is it Get Balsamic Vinegar, Quick You Fool?
It is Get From Love Songs from Polar Bears. That was... Do you ever play that live?
No, we used to play it. And then we brought it back into the set to much confusion around sort of Final Straw time.
Right.
When, you know, nobody had that first record.
Yeah, yeah.
So it confused the heck out of people.
I imagine that first record, you must have talked about this lots of times, but that first record, when people discover your music now and they go back to that first one, it does have them scratching their heads a little bit.
Probably does, yeah.
But I remember loving it at the time it came out.
Well, thank you. Bless your heart.
You
were one of the few hundred that did. No, there weren't. Lean years. Thanks for the memories.
You're playing a couple of South American festivals soon.
We are.
Now, we hear bands come in and say, oh, those South American gigs, they're just crazy, they're amazing. Why? How is that? What is different about them?
I don't know if they're... We've only played one. So we've only played one South American one. We've played Mexico, and that was amazing. Central America, South America, I guess.
Yeah.
Latin America, let's call it that. And let's say that the Mexican gigs are a part of that fine tradition of crazy
sure.
gigs.
They
really
how
were
are they crazy.
People let themselves go. People are having fun right from the beginning. You don't need to warm them up. They seem already warmed up. They're pre-warmed. It's like Meals on Wheels. They're just ready for you, I guess. And they go, and they get increasingly more and more crazy. They start strong and end, you know, at sort of fever pitch. And
has anyone ever congered at a Snow Patrol gig?
No, I would love to see that though. They probably could have conged easily around our first 10 years of gigs, you know, just like the 40 people that are in the crowd just congering round in circles.
And then
no obstructions.
I take it after the album there's going to be some gigs here in the UK and the rest of Europe as well.
Yes.
They've not been announced yet.
No, they're being announced soon. It's January, February for the UK and Ireland tour.
And when you're at the stage where you've already played arenas and stadiums, as somebody who wants to keep the audience happy in these ways, you're thinking, okay, this is our next tour. How do we go about making that more of a special thing? What is the next thing that you can do?
Well, it's learning, I guess, because we've went from very small rooms for a very long time to bigger rooms and bigger rooms. It's learning the difference between a gig and a show.
Right.
Because, you know, at the beginning when we play in bigger rooms, we were still playing the same way that we played in the smaller rooms. Mm. And even though it feels maybe like a small betrayal to your history,
yeah,
it's really not when you come down to it. It's really about the enjoyment in the room. If you want to make the enjoyment better, you've got to make a spectacle.
Sure, someone's paying £37.50 or whatever a gig ticket costs, you want to make it a good
experience
for them.
It's got to be a spectacle too. And that's what we try and do. We try and outdo the spectacle of the last time. I guess the biggest sort of visually and sonically kind of set piece of the last tour was when we played the full 16 minutes of the lightning strike, and we had these mad visuals, a kind of a visual story. It was all very Pink Floyd.
Yeah.
So this time round, we kind of want to outdo that, and find something that is yet more stunning.
I suggest a cape.
Well, that has crossed my mind. No, maybe sort of break into Phantom of the Opera halfway through the gig. I'll wear a like half mask.
Right, I'm getting on Ticketmaster straight away. I'm pressing refresh until they go on sale. Gary, thank you very much for coming and talking to us.
Thank you very much for having me.
And best of luck with the record.
Thank you.